Hello everyone, thank you for joining our webinar today. This webinar titled Challenges of Clinical Research in Parkinson's Disease will be presented by Vice President of Neuroscience for Worldwide Clinical Trials, Dr. Tom Babick. Tom, I'd like to turn the presentation over to you at this time. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Good morning, good afternoon everyone. Thank you very much for coming for today's presentation regarding challenges of clinical research in Parkinson's disease, which will take about 45 minutes and 15 minutes will be left for your questions and comments. I will, at the beginning, touch a little bit neurobiology of Parkinson's disease. Then after that, we'll tell you a little bit more about methodology of drug development in various stages of Parkinson's disease. Then finally, we will touch neuroprotection concept in Parkinson's disease and which lessons we have been learned so far doing clinical trials in Parkinson's disease. You know that Parkinson's disease is a progressive degenerative disorder of CNS, but not only CNS. It seems that Parkinson's disease is more or less generalized disease, which we will see later. But classical concept is involving degeneration of basal ganglia neurons with the accumulation of the alpha-synuclein specific protein, which is forming Lewy bodies. You can see one of these Lewy body on the right-hand side of your slide. The prevalence of disease, particularly in elderly population, might be more than 3%, and the average onset of disease is about 60. We will talk today exclusively about sporadic Parkinson's disease. We will not touch genetic form of Parkinson's disease, which are usually starting in earliest age, let's say about 40 or 30. Well, the incidence of Parkinson's disease, it seems to be about 20 new cases per year per 100,000 people, and there are several risk factors which are being involved in Parkinson's disease development. But when we are talking about idiopathic Parkinson's disease, which is the most common one, at the moment we do not have a particular epidemiological risk factor which might be directly connected with this disease, apart of the some pesticides, herbicides, and non-smoking history. This is the only one disease where smoking might be protecting against disease. What is the evolution of Parkinson's disease? We know today that we need about 50 to 70% of dopaminergic neurons damaged to have a clinical expression of disease. So apparently, the pathological process is starting much earlier, and you can see in this slide the evolution according to Brack hypothesis, the evolution of alpha-synuclein accumulation forming Lewy body formations from brainstem spreading up to the basal ganglia and finally spreading to the cortex. At the final stage in BRAC 5 and 6 stage, we have not only deposition of Lewy body within a brainstem, but we can also have a deposition of Lewy body in patient's cortex. In that stage, we basically have a clinical expression very close to Lewy body dementia or Parkinson's disease dementia, which are clinically very difficult to be diagnosed and distinguished. The entire disease, the Parkinson's disease, as we already said, it's not only exclusively neurological disorder, because if you see the evolution of symptoms, you can see practically some symptoms which are occurring before classical expression of disease. So apparently, patients can have some signs of depression. They can have anosmia or hyposmia. They can have extensive daily sleeping period. Also, REM behavioral diseases is very common in patients with Parkinson's disease, and it seems that the earliest symptom, of course non-specific, for Parkinson's disease might be constipation, so even 20 years before clinical expression of disease. Of course, the hallmark of Parkinson's disease, which classical book says, are bradykinesia, rigidity, and tremor, which are the main symptoms and signs of clinically evident Parkinson's disease. And after that, we can also can see progression of disease, which is inevitable in case of Parkinson's disease, leading to fluctuations, dyskinesia, psychosis, and dysphagia, postural instability, freezing, falls, urinary symptoms, dementia, orthostatic hypotension. So practically entire brain is involved by pathological process, which is pathological accumulation of alpha-synuclein. Of course, to make our job easier, there are some potential biomarkers that we are using in a diagnosis of Parkinson's disease. Some of them might be used as longitudinal biomarkers in some drug testing, although at the moment we cannot say that there is one longitudinal biomarker which could be golden standard in the assessment of drug effect in Parkinson's disease. So you can see the entire list of various biomarkers that we are using in diagnosis of Parkinson's disease, including olfactory impairment, polysomnography for REM behavior disorders, various sorts of CNS imaging, which are including specific PET and SPECT scan, then diffusion tensor imaging with the MRI, transcranial sonography, which is also a valuable method, and also something which is really new, it's a cardiac imaging with specific tracer called methiodobenzylguanidine, which is basically detecting sympathetic damage in patients with Parkinson's disease, and it seems that these signs might be present pretty early in the Parkinson's disease process, and this bioimaging have been recently involved in a criteria for diagnosis of Parkinson's disease using so-called Movement Disorder Society criteria, which are published recently. Although the classical approach to Parkinson's disease research is using UK Brain Bank criteria. On the other side, there are several areas where we can identify alpha-synuclein staining, which could be in colon, it could be in skin, and recently in lingual glands. This is very important. It means that alpha-synuclein is not only specificum of CNS, could be seen also in other part of the body. Regarding biochemical biomarkers, CSF sampling can be rich with alpha-synuclein, but we have to be careful because alpha-synuclein is 95% of alpha-synuclein is based in erythrocytes, so if there is artificial blood in CSF, then we can have a wrong impression of alpha-synuclein content in CSF. Also, at the moment, we have no biomarker in saliva or urine, although apparently there are some existing. In blood, there are some non-specific biomarkers like uric acid and glutathione. To conclude biomarker story, at the moment, only biomarkers can be used in diagnostic procedure, not in a follow-up, not in a longitudinal research, although PET scan, 18 fluorodopa PET scan, was used in a well-known study called Real PET scan, where we basically proven neuroprotective effect of a dopaminergic agonist, rapinrol, and this study took place 15 years ago. What is the patient's preference regarding PD treatment? So not each symptom might be difficult for patients. So we made some research, and also going from literature, it seems that tremor and the motor off status, where patient is completely immobile, is probably the most difficult symptoms for our patients. And at the moment, there are several drugs in a standard treatment of Parkinson's disease, which are including amantadine not only for dyskinesia recently licensed. Amantadine is old drug, very well known in the past for treatment of early Parkinson's disease. NOB inhibitors, anticholinergic, still in some usage in Central and Eastern Europe and Asia. Of course, levodopa, carbidopa is basically golden standard for treatment of Parkinson's disease, dopaminergic agonists, and also levodopa in combination with the CMT inhibitor. What is the most important part of levodopa is that, in fact, levodopa is the most effective anti-Parkinsonian drug which can decrease mortality of Parkinson's disease, and this was conclusion from the consensus meeting in Paris nearly 20 years ago. Apparently, so far, nothing importantly changed, although we know that there are several stages of the response in levodopa treatment. So basically, we know because of the lack of sufficient neurons and the progressive nature of disease, we have a very good response at the beginning on levodopa treatment, but as disease is progressing and also as we are increasing levodopa dosing, we finally have a regular end of dose wearing off phenomenon, where basically levodopa is affecting only 4 to 6 hours instead of 8 to 10 hours at the beginning, and also disease is progressing, levodopa is less effective, we have a frequent wearing off phenomenon with unpredictable dose response. Okay, so now when we have a typical Parkinson's disease from diagnosis then to late stage, we can follow several different part of disease development and also several different subjects group which might be important for our clinical research. So just briefly, we can talk about early Parkinson's disease and advanced Parkinson's disease, where we have dyskinesia, where we have fluctuations phenomenon, all of these complications. So neither of these part of disease is well treated so far. So there are plenty of medical needs that we need to follow, especially in early Parkinson's disease, which is basically neuroprotection, to ensure neuroprotection, to improve symptomatic treatment of the levodopa at the beginning, and also we should try to find something which will prevent levodopa-induced complications which are inevitable during the progression of disease. In terms of medical need in advanced stage of Parkinson's disease, we definitely need to find something which will be helpful for levodopa-induced complication, and also something which will treat other complications and which will improve quality of life of our patients. However, the motor complications of Parkinson's disease are very common, so practically after 10 years of treatment, you can see that practically 100% of patients can have complications, including wearing off phenomenon, unpredictable on and off, dyskinesia, and also off-period dystonia, biphasic dyskinesia. So these complications are definitely subject of levodopa treatment duration, levodopa daily dose, age of Parkinson's disease, onset, duration of Parkinson's disease, and also severity and progression. So we basically need to fight with all of these symptoms in advanced stage of Parkinson's disease. I will not go in details through pathogenesis of levodopa-induced motor complications, but we can say that these are basically consequences of peripheral pharmacokinetics, pharmacodynamics, and central pharmacokinetics, of course, including also degenerative nature of Parkinson's disease, with more and more dopaminergic neurons failed. And finally, we have three the most important side effects of levodopa treatment, which is wearing off, on-off, and dyskinesia, which are usually consequence of pulsatile dopaminergic stimulation. So now we will talk a little bit more about methodology of drug development in various stages of Parkinson's. Parkinson's disease, we basically identified three different most important stages of Parkinson's disease. Of course, there are more. We can discuss about each symptom separately, but now I made it three different groups which are important for clinical research, and I will show you what are the most important challenges of three different groups of patients. So the first group of patients are patients with only motor symptoms present or early Parkinson's disease, then patients with motor fluctuations, and finally patients with troublesome dyskinesia. See, in all of these patients, diagnosis of idiopathic Parkinson's disease should be made according to criteria. The most popular are UK Brain Bank, although recently published MDS criteria will be definitely in use shortly, so we will not go through these criteria, but fortunately these criteria are very sensitive and specific, so we can say that nearly 85% of patients are correctly diagnosed. 15% other patients are belonging to so-called Parkinson plus disorders, where we can sometimes count differentiate over idiopathic Parkinson's disease. The stage of disease in various of these conditions is different. So stage of disease might be expressed as a Henin-Yahr stage. So I'm showing here a modified stage. So basically, motor symptoms in early Parkinson's disease will be explored in patients with early disease, Henin-Yahr between 1 and 3, or Henin-Yahr modified between 1 and 2.5, which means that patients have no disequilibrium, autonomic disequilibrium. In case of motor fluctuation and troublesome dyskinesia, we need a little bit advanced patients, which are Henin-Yahr between 2 and 4. Inclusion criteria for early Parkinson's disease in terms of stage of motor symptoms should be expressed through Unified Parkinson's Disease Rating Scale, so part 3, so usually we need patients at least 10 and higher score on UPDRS. However, UPDRS cannot be neither primary endpoint nor in specific inclusion criteria for patients in advanced stage, where basically a clinically dominating problem is either motor fluctuation or troublesome dyskinesia. So in terms of motor fluctuation, we need patients who are more than 2.5 hours in their awake stage, daily or in off stage. Or, in case of troublesome dyskinesia, we need score more than 10 in abnormally involuntary movement scales. Of course, there are some similar cutoffs that could be used instead, but this is basically what is the most common in majority of clinical trials. Primary endpoints in motor symptoms assessment should be always either UPDRS-3, which is direct measurement of the symptoms, or UPDRS-2, which is in fact activities of daily living collected by interview and related to previous 2 weeks on patients. Motor fluctuation primary endpoint could be obtained from the patient's diary, which is where patient is recording some symptoms and signs every half an hour. In troublesome dyskinesia, primary endpoints are specific scales which will be used for the assessment of patients. There are many of them. The most popular at the moment is a Unified Disease Rating Scale. However, very often we are using abnormal involuntary movement scale, which was originally developed for schizophrenia, for assessment of side effects of neuroleptics in schizophrenia. We basically need that patients in advanced stage could have evidence of levodopa response. This might be leg act is done through hospitalization and drug holiday during the 12 hours and levodopa challenge next day, where the translation from patients off to his on should be difference of more than 30% on UPDRS. Very often these criteria can be skipped in clinical trials, and we basically assume that patients have a levodopa response on the basis of clinical judgment. Daily dose of levodopa equivalent should be stable, and it should be at least given 3 times per day. Common exclusion are dementia patients. Patients who are on treatment with apomorphine, where basically we have a prompt reaction of a patient's motoric symptoms, so we have an unstable condition, of course. Patients who are on antipsychotics, patients who had a brain surgery for Parkinson's disease, orthostatic hypotension, which can jeopardize results of the safety in clinical trials, unpredictable on and off psychosis and freezing episodes. These are basically common exclusion criteria for patients with Parkinson's disease. What are efficacy endpoints in various stages of Parkinson's disease? You can see here, in early stage of Parkinson's disease where there is no levodopa fluctuation, this is definitely total UPDRS or UPDRS3 or combination between UPDRS 2 and 3. And also, if we are assessing in early Parkinson's disease patients without treatment, we can basically explore time needed to see start medication of levodopa or time needed to see motor fluctuation. This outcome measure time needed to start medication is very often recommended in a so-called neuroprotective trial where patients will be exposed to new drug prior to levodopa. And when patient needs levodopa, this might be primary endpoint. Although this strategy was used so far in several trials, we haven't seen any drug who basically replaced levodopa or who showed something clinically important with this design. Also, in advanced stage of Parkinson's disease, we are using a specific on-off diary, or as we said, we are using specific scales for dyskinesia. UPDRS from off to on might be also one of the outcome measures, not very often, and also time from on to off might be used usually in a phase 4 program. Secondary endpoints, you can see the list here, which are usually quality of life, patient's impression of changes, and similar. Exploratory endpoints at the moment are non-motor symptoms assessment and specific bio markers that we already showed in this presentation. In this slide, you have a difference between the classical UPDRS and new movement disorder society UPDRS. Some of you who are familiar with Parkinson's disease research know that there are two different UPDRS at the moment. The classical UPDRS has only 4 items in non-motor assessment, 13 items in daily living assessment, 27 items on motor examination, and 9 on motor complication. MDS UPDRS is slightly different. Practically, the increased number of non-motor symptoms which should be assessed. Also, daily living is pretty the same, whereas motor examination is going to be wider, affecting a little bit more functions, whereas motor complications could be expressed only through 6 different items. At the moment, it seems that MDS-UPDRS is becoming more popular in clinical trials, but we need to know that plenty of drugs have been developed on UPDRS classical form, and that's why we cannot compare data from already done clinical trials, because it's practically not possible to compare UPDRS-3 data from MDS-UPDRS and the classical UPDRS because of the difference in number of assessed symptoms. Here you can see classical motor fluctuation diary in patients with Parkinson's disease, which is enhanced with the assessment of dyskinesia on left-hand side. This pictogram diary looks very interesting, and patients are pretty happy to do this diary. There are some electronics trials to fill in these diaries. We had no great experience with electronic diaries in Parkinson's disease patients because of the specific task that every half an hour patient must fill in his diary how he feels, whereas in some other diaries, like in epilepsy and pain, you need to do it only in case if you have a seizure or if you have a pain. Treatment of Parkinson's disease in advanced stage is pretty difficult because the therapeutic wideness is much lower in advanced stage of Parkinson's disease than in early Parkinson's disease. So you can see here what is the plasma levodopa dose needed to have a very good anti-Parkinsonian effect in comparison with those needed to produce dyskinesia. However, we know that levodopa end of dose wearing off phenomenon with predictable on and off should definitely be seen in a patient in advanced stage of disease, and we need to be careful about interpretation of data, because primary endpoints are always depending on patient's diary. So patients must be extremely well trained, his physician must be well trained, because believe me, patients are not always able to recognize what is the off and on. Very often they can assume that off is practically side effect of something. Also, we know that placebo responders among Parkinson's disease patients are pretty high, and we know that placebo response in their patients is a chemical phenomenon, that dopaminergic activity is much higher, and also in advanced stage of Parkinson's disease, we have less neurons preserved, and in that sense, we have a lower therapeutic reserve in these patients. So if you have a drug, which you mean that might be useful in Parkinson's disease in advanced stage, then you are not sure are you going to start with a clinical trials in advanced stage or early stage, please bear in mind that low therapeutic reserve in advanced stage might jeopardize a final results of your patient, and you are more safe if you plan to develop drug in the early stage of Parkinson's disease. But in the early stage of Parkinson's disease, these clinical trials are longer, and I'm afraid more difficult to have a patient. Just for your information, a few examples of off time in various clinical trials. So far, it seems that regulatory might accept 48 minutes as the lower difference between active and endpoints in terms of off reduction. I haven't seen any drug who was licensed with a difference lower than 48 minutes, so it seems that this is definitely minimum if you are assessing off time as a primary endpoint. Of course, in advanced stage of Parkinson's disease, as you are treating on-off phenomenon, if you increase dose of levodopa, you should be aware that patient might have a dyskinesia. And as long as we are improving patient's UPDRS, we have a more chance in advanced stage that patient would have a dyskinesia. Dyskinesia is always present during the patient's off. Very rarely we can find dyskinesia in patient off period. This was only one example with the transportation of the some cells in one paper several years ago. But in the real practice, dyskinesia is always following immediate improvement of patient's motor phase after levodopa challenge or similar drug. Ideal dyskinesia assessment scale should basically capture patients' perceptions of dyskinesia. Very often patients are not aware of their dyskinesia. They basically need to follow dyskinesia in every anatomical patient distribution. It should be objective, and also also dyskinesia skill should capture disability. Of course, this might be done by movement disorder specialist by all means. You can see here several lists of dyskinesia assessment skills. Some of them are subjective, some of them are objective. I will not go through, but what is important, as I already said, dyskinesia is always following patients on. So in fact, the results of dyskinesia assessment must be always analyzed in association with the severity of motor Parkinsonism at that time and duration of patients off and on. So if we have, for instance, very good response on some drug using dyskinesia rating scale, and at that time we have a worsening of patients off, either in severity or duration, this is definitely not what we want from this drug for dyskinesia. And finally, I'm going to touch point of neuroprotection in Parkinson's disease, which is practically the great challenge of the research. And why neuroprotection trials in Parkinson's disease failed so far? All of them practically failed. So there are several reasons, which basically I listed here. So the precise cause of pathogenesis of Parkinson's disease is not known. It might be more than one. Apparently, there are not animal models which can accurately reflect the age-related slowly progressive neurodegenerative disorders. Also, Parkinson's disease has a variable clinical progression, and it is very often age of onset dependent. On the other side, availability of very potent and effective symptomatic drugs at the beginning of treatment, like levodopa and dopaminergic agonists, of course, will make design of clinical trial much more difficult. In fact, none of the available clinical or imaging measures accurately assess all aspects of complex neurodegenerative process. We've seen at the beginning that practically is involving every part of the brain. Also, neuroprotective drug can demonstrate a long-term safety profile, which means that practically every patient should be free of important side effects after several months of treatment, because neuroprotection is a live treatment. And also, the development of the effective neuroprotective therapy will probably require conceptual change, accepting the potential contribution of multiple pathogenic mechanisms. And also, there are some evidences that some sort of combination therapy might be important. Because of all of these challenges in neuroprotection, Movement Disorder Society group developed criteria for so-called prodromal Parkinson's disease, like we have in Alzheimer's disease, prodromal Alzheimer's disease. We have now criteria established for prodromal Parkinson's disease, which are basically mainly focused to patients in pre-early stage of Parkinson's disease for clinical trial purposes. So basically, this criteria is more important for clinical trials than for everyday clinical practice. So we know that Parkinson's disease is nothing else than loss of dopaminergic neurons, and at the same time, at the beginning, we have no motor symptoms, but when early motor symptoms occur, we have a diagnosis of Parkinson's disease that we already showed at the beginning. So, what are risk factors important to develop Parkinson's disease? Inevitably, they are age, family history, environment, genetics, gender, and also smoking history. But also, there are some premotor markers that we can consider as a potentially important symptoms and signs in patients with further Parkinson's disease, which are poor olfactory function, constipation, REM sleep disorder, autonomic problems, depression, and also enhanced signal from substantia nigra using transcranial echo imaging. So these symptoms, these premotor markers, together with risk factors, have been considered together with the specific factors of the risk, and now we are able to calculate potential risk of a further development Parkinson's disease for diagnosis of prodromal. At the moment, there is no any study which was done in prodromal Parkinson's disease because these criteria have been published just 6 months ago, but I'm pretty sure this is the important step forward to diagnose people who might have a Parkinson's disease in the future and try with potential neuroprotective related clinical trials. Of course, if we are able to make to identify our subjects or patients before diagnosis and have a high probability that they would have a Parkinson's disease, we can start with neuroprotection before diagnosis of Parkinson's disease in so-called prodromal Parkinson's disease. I'm pretty sure these trials will be very expensive. They should be extremely, extremely well designed. And at the moment, as I said, I haven't seen any of these trials in the clinical practice yet. Just a few words about clinical trials design done so far in neuroprotective Parkinson's disease patients. So there are practically three different types, which is a classical parallel group design, including futility design. There are also washout design and also delayed start design. None of these design practically showed any important evidences of the neuroprotection of all of these compounds. Of course, levodopa study, which was a levodopa study, showed some evidences of neuroprotection. But in every case, disadvantages of this clinical trials are mainly long placebo exposure, and this is something that we definitely need to find a way how to change that. And also there is a limitation in washout phase with a difficulty excluding persistent symptomatic effects in a patient with a Parkinson's disease. So neuroprotection will be definitely a great challenge for the further clinical trials. What are endpoints in neuroprotective clinical trials? You can see here. So usually there are motor scores and with slope analysis, but also there are some changes in biomarkers. This is what we've seen so far. However, there are some potential endpoints which we haven't used so far in clinical trials, but they might be of interest, which are non-motor scores, brain metabolism, specific MRI morphology changes, and quality of life. So finally, which lessons we learn practically in clinical trials for Parkinson's disease, and how we can design the further clinical trials in Parkinson's disease? Of course, we need to take in account all of our knowledge about clinical research in Parkinson's disease, what was published in negative and positive clinical trials, our own experience. Of course, we need to explore particular drug pharmacokinetics, pharmacodynamics. We have to be expert in translational medicine. Or if we satisfy all of these criteria in pre-setting clinical trial, finally, we need to find the best way how to select potential patients and sites. Of course, we are very keen to have majority of key opinion leaders in clinical research. Of course, they are there are key opinion leaders of many companies at the same time, and of course they are not able to provide what we are expecting from them in terms of number of recruited patients. So in that sense, we always make a balance between key opinion leaders and outstanding investigators. They are not always the same people. We always thinking about contingency plan and to have a pre-qualified site and countries, and not all of good sites are for every Parkinson disease trial, and not every country is for every phase of Parkinson disease clinical trial. Of course, this is very often subject to competitive ongoing studies. That's why we need feasibility assessment, but the main question in our feasibility are competitive studies and sites' motivation for this particular trial. What is very important, and fortunately this is very common in Parkinson disease trials, that protocols are simple and doable. For the difference in Alzheimer's disease, where protocols are so complicated, where people might be exposed to investigators more than 5 hours during the examination, in Parkinson's disease, fortunately, this time is much lower, and definitely patients are more or less happy to take part in clinical trials. Parkinson's disease patients are very interested in clinical trials, and particularly those who are in advanced stage, they are often asking if you have something new for me. Of course, placebo response is inevitable in patients with Parkinson's disease, particularly in early stage, so we need to consider different study design, enhanced patient population, and also rigorous training and certification. We would reduce variability among raters, with of course central interactive real-time monitoring of diagnostic and assessment data. Every new measure which will control physicians and raters should be faster than usual than they usually practice. This might be sometimes problem with the new computerized techniques, who are a little bit slower, although we are expecting that computerized system might be more friendly. So finally, instead of conclusion, what is the key macro factors for successful clinical trial, which means to meet study objectives in a timeline provided, which is definitely protocol should be state of art, with a well-selected study population, endpoint selection, assessment tools and training, and sample size. On the other side, investigators' team should be quality proven, highly motivated, and of course, if it is possible, not involved in competitive studies, but unfortunately, this is very difficult to have. Realistic timelines means neither too short nor too long. Recruitment period of 1 year so far in Parkinson's disease research in early Parkinson's disease seems to be the most applicable for majority of investigators. Advanced stage Parkinson's disease, because these patients are easier to be recruited, might be done in 9 months of the recruitment period process. And finally, for the success, therapeutically specified and up-to-date trained proactive management is inevitable to achieve study objective and endpoints in the timelines given. This is all what I had regarding Parkinson's disease challenges in clinical research. I only opened the door of the very big room with a lot of challenges, and in fact every particular symptom, every particular problem might have a lot of different solutions and plenty of our discussions, but I guess this presentation gave you just an in view of the comprehensive clinical research challenges in different patients with Parkinson's disease. Thank you.
Thank you, Tom. Thank you, Tom. We do have a few questions that have been submitted. Starting out, and I apologize in advance if I'm not pronouncing everything correctly, but Tom, we have a question here. What percentage of Parkinson's patients currently have L-DOPA-induced dyskinesis?
This is a very good question. I need to point out that in advanced stage of Parkinson's disease, we can have between 50% and 70% of patients who have a levodopa-induced dyskinesia. However, troublesome dyskinesia could be seen in half of these patients who are presenting with dyskinesia, because very often patients are not aware of their dyskinesia. Dyskinesia would definitely come in patients with long treatment and also very high dose of levodopa. One of the good examples regarding dyskinesia and Parkinson's disease is, in fact, when we started with levodopa in early 70s, we basically accepted the paradigm of antibiotic treatments, which is the highest dose in a shorter time. This is what we've done in Parkinson's disease, and today we know this is wrong. But at that time, we basically exposed our patients to maximum tolerating levodopa dose, and practically 50% of them developed dyskinesia in 1 year treatment. And if you see old papers from 72, 73, 74, you can see that vast majority of patients had dyskinesia. Now, we realize that this concept was not good, that better is to go low, to start slow, but go with levodopa, to spare patients as much as possible to reduce potential side effects. Then we can probably postpone development of dyskinesia and other symptoms as well of levodopa side effects after 5 or 10 years. But in fact, frankly speaking, after 5 years of treatment, we can have at least 50% of patients with dyskinesia, and troublesome dyskinesia will be seen in about 25% of them.
Thank you, Tom. We have another question here. How important is individual dosing in patient therapy?
This is a very good question. This is very important, and this is, in fact, what every physician can do on his own. He has to follow his own experience and patient's response, because we know that 20% of patients are fast deteriorators. It seems that this is age-related, age-of-onset-related, but in fact, every patient should be approached differently in terms of treatment. So, for instance, if you have a patient who is quite young, then majority of investigators and key opinion leaders would suggest you to start with dopaminergic agonists. And this is a really good concept. But however, in patients with 70, with 65 or 70, where Parkinson's disease is also very common, this strategy might be not the best option, because the higher number of psychosis and adverse events on direct levodopa. So in fact, you need always balance between patient's age, various factors which are influencing a drug effect. So, for instance, patients who are taking highly protein food, their patients should change their diet, because highly proteinized food might be a problem with the levodopa resorption. So every patient is difficult. Treatment of Parkinson's disease, roughly speaking, at the beginning is pretty easy if you are a specialist, and it's very difficult even if you are a very good specialist. It's very difficult after 5 or 10 years. So that's why no one of our who are dealing with these patients is not happy to take patients after 10 or 15 years from our colleagues and other physicians. So this might be a problem for them. And also, very often patients, particularly in Europe, can do self-medication, particularly if you are very well educated. Web pages are available to everyone. They can start reading. Sometimes they are taking some drugs which they can have from web page, and with more and more data, treatment is becoming more and more difficult and challengeable.
Great. Thank you, Tom. We have another question. Is there any evidence that neuroinflammation contributes to the pathocyte physiology of Parkinson's disease, especially dysfunction of the innate immune system?
They are. We basically are doing one study at the moment. I'm sorry, I cannot tell you more about this study. But what we are doing now, we are looking how to suppress microglia activation as a consequence of neuroinflammatory process in Parkinson's disease. Apparently, it seems that at the end of the pathological process, neuroinflammation, of course, non-septic neuroinflammation, might play important role. It did in pathogenesis of Parkinson and Alzheimer's disease. I'm not sure at the moment that we can have such a good evidences of neuroinflammation like we had in sporadic patients with Alzheimer's disease who were treated with non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs. But if you see that, for instance, manganese-driven Parkinson's disease, you know that mangan might be one of the potential cause of Parkinson's disease, and the people with manganese Parkinsonism are endemic in south of China, where plenty of mines of mangan are still in work. So all of these people who developed manganese Parkinsonism were treated very well with para-aminosalicyl acid, which was one of the old drug for tuberculosis. So this is one of the potential evidence that neuroinflammation might play a role in Parkinson's disease pathogenesis.
Thanks, Tom. We have several more questions. If we're not able to get to them all, we will make sure that Tom gets these questions so that he can follow up with you after the meeting. I'm going to go to the next question. Is there a rank order in premotor markers, for example, with respect to impact on patient quality of life and or appearance of the markers?
This is a very good question. I'm sorry, at the moment, I'm not sure what I can say. This is really important. It seems that olfactory changes and array behavioral changes might be one of the most important biomarkers, but they are already ranked with specific number in terms of their potential risk of Parkinson's disease, and giving different numbers from the Movement Disorder Society, different, I would say, quotient or different K level, they might be considered as a different in terms of rank order. So to answer your question, yes, I think they are.
Okay. Thank you, Tom. Another question. You briefly discussed identification of prodromal patients for possible prevention studies. Can you comment on what you envision the primary outcome of such a study would need to be for regulatory approval, and also what observation period you would envision would be needed based on the current knowledge around conversion rates?
Well, at the moment, for me, it seems that the introduction of levodopa and diagnosis of definite Parkinson's disease might be one of the endpoints, particular endpoints as in outcome measures. I would say diagnosis of a definite diagnosis of Parkinson's disease and need for levodopa treatment. That might be at the moment the closest markers.
Okay, thank you. And here's another question. Is the classification of Parkinson's disease patients according to the symptoms genetics useful in RCT design?
Excuse me, I didn't quite quite catch what you just say. I didn't hear the question. Can you repeat, please?
Sure. Is the classification of Parkinson's disease patients according to the symptoms and or genetics useful in RCT design?
No, I wouldn't say that. No, I still believe that these patients are belonging to the different subject populations in terms of patients with early Parkinson's, so I mean with or without treatment with levodopa, and also complication as a consequence of levodopa. So this is at the moment, and also, of course, if you are targeting specific symptoms, this is basically a typical symptomatic treatment for symptoms, but not for Parkinson's disease. So, for instance, dementia in Parkinson's disease is treatment of dementia, not treatment of Parkinson's disease.
Okay. Well, I think we have room for maybe one more question. What are the important covariants to consider in the analysis of the results of Parkinson's disease RCTs? How are you still there?
Yeah. Excuse me. What is the question?
What are the important covariates to consider in the analysis of the results of Parkinson's disease RCTs?
Do you mean which? I'm not sure if I understand the question correctly, if it is related to early Parkinson's disease or advanced Parkinson's disease, because they are different.
Okay. Well, here's another question, if that one seems a little tough to answer. Can you speak about Parkinson's disease, dementia, and psychosis associated with Parkinson's disease as the targets for treatment trials?
Yeah, of course. There are two different conditions. Parkinson's disease, dementia, apparently is an inevitable consequence of a long-term Parkinson's disease and ages. Psychosis is a definitely levodopa-related consequence. So basically, I'm pretty sure in patients with Parkinson's disease with no levodopa treatment, nobody would have a psychosis. However, patients with no no levodopa treatment, they would have Parkinson's disease dementia. So this is the main difference. Psychosis in Parkinson's disease is inevitably a consequence of dopaminergic agonists or levodopa action of dopaminergic agonists.
Okay. Well, I think that brings us to the end of our session. We missed a few questions, but Tom, we'll get those to you. We have the contact information for those who asked the questions, so we'll allow you to follow up with those. Thank you very much, Tom. We appreciate your presentation today.
Thank you, and thank you very much for your time.
Thanks, everyone.